Most surface texture parameters are calculated with one or more filters. For profile parameters, the filtration is reflected in the parameter name. PQ for a primary profile, RQ for roughness, and WQ for waviness. But in the case of a surface, the name is unchanged. For example, SQ will remain SQ, regardless of the filtration. The role of these filters is fundamental in the parameter results. A filter can completely change the value of a parameter. That is why providing a parameter result without giving its filtration context is useless, since you can obtain any value by changing the filter type and cutoff. It is important to understand how filters work and what they are used for in order to use them correctly. Many parameters are obtained by summing a function of heights. For example, on a profile, the RA parameter is the sum of the absolute values of the heights. For the RQ parameter, it is the sum of the squares of the heights, and so on. All heights are referenced to the mean line, which is obtained by filtering. A filter is used to calculate a simplified version of the profile that only contains the large height variation trends. It is the waviness profile. This waviness acts as a reference line for the roughness profile, since roughness corresponds to the deviation of the original profile with respect to the waviness profile. Roughness is therefore the result of the subtraction of waviness from the primary profile. The strength of a filter can be adjusted using a cutoff, which determines the amount of details to be removed from the original profile. It works a bit like a sieve that retains particles larger than a given size depending on the size of the mesh. The cutoff value must be selected according to the application and the level of details that need to be kept and characterized on the roughness. As a reminder, when a profile is measured on a part, for example a mechanical part, the measured profile contains several components. It contains the nominal form, which is the native geometrical form, defined in the drawing. It can be a simple line in the case of a planar surface, or a circle arc in the case of a cylinder. This form is removed before performing the surface texture analysis. The form deviation provides information on the quality of machining, the respect of the intended shape, and sometimes on the adjustment of the machining tool. For example, an off-centered part on the machine tool will introduce runout, which is a periodic deviation from the nominal circular shape. Waviness and roughness are the main surface texture components, and they play a different functional role. The three last components, form deviation, waviness, and roughness, are identified and separated using filters, each one configured with a specific cutoff. The form is usually removed using an association, for example with the least squares method. In order to understand how filters work and how they affect signals, it is convenient to use an analogy with audio and sound signals. A bass sound emits a low-frequency wave whose oscillations are relatively slow. A high-pitched sound emits a high-frequency wave that oscillates very quickly. In both cases, we have the same waveform, in this case a sinusoid, but on a different frequency. A sound wave propagates as a function of time. Its propagation speed depends on the medium, air, water, etc. The amplitude of the signal around zero can easily be measured, for example using an oscilloscope connected to a microphone. This amplitude corresponds to the sound volume of the wave. A pure note is a sinusoidal signal which oscillates regularly at a given frequency. We can count the number of oscillations and measure their duration in seconds. Here, for example, there are four oscillations over a period of 0.4 seconds. This corresponds to a frequency of 10 Hz. The frequency is calculated by the ratio between the number of periods and the time elapsed. In other words, it is the number of oscillations per second. The official unit of frequency is Hz, which is the reciprocal of a second. The wave therefore propagates at a speed that depends on the medium and the nature of the wave, sound, light, electrical, etc. For example, a sound wave travels through air at about 340 meters per second. A radio wave, or a light wave, propagates in vacuum at the speed of light, which is 300,000 kilometers per second. We can define the wavelength as being the ratio between the speed of propagation and the frequency of the signal. For example, a radio wave at 300 kHz corresponds to a wavelength of 1 kilometer. The wavelength of a 300 MHz signal is 1 meter. In the case of a profilometer, heights are measured as a function of the lateral position x, measured in millimeters. This is why, in surface texture, we more readily use the notion of wavelength rather than that of frequency. It should nevertheless be kept in mind that these two notions are dual. That is to say that they represent the same thing, expressed differently. A sinusoidal profile will be characterized by its amplitude, A, its wavelength, lambda, and its phase, phi. The phase is simply the starting position of the wave at t equals zero. Phase is measured in degrees or radians. The phase does not influence the behavior of the wave, but it modifies its synchronization. A sinusoid with a phase of 180 degrees corresponds to the inverted sinusoid. So, if we sum two sinusoids of the same frequency and the same amplitude, one with a phase of 0 degrees and the other with a phase of 180 degrees, we obtain a zero signal. This is the principle of noise-canceling headphones. In reality, signals are not just sinusoids, but represent any signal variations. They can be used to represent, for example, the topography of a surface measured by a profilometer. But signal theory specifies that any signal can be decomposed into a Fourier series. That is to say, a sum of pure sinusoids, each characterized by its frequency, its amplitude, and its phase. This is the spectrum of a signal. A signal can be decomposed into its spectrum, but also reconstructed from its spectrum. Thus, by progressively summing all the sinusoids resulting from the Fourier series decomposition, we gradually approach the shape of the original signal. Here, an example with a signal in rectangular slots. This is what the Fourier transform does. It takes a given signal, in the spatial domain, and gives us its spectrum, in the frequency domain. And vice versa with the inverse Fourier transform. The spectrum of a perfectly sinusoidal wave will, by definition, consist of a single spectral ray, since its Fourier series decomposition has only one term. The spectral ray is displayed at the position corresponding to its frequency, and its height corresponds to the amplitude of the sine. A single spectral ray is called a Dirac. A signal composed of two sinusoids at different frequencies and amplitudes will show a spectrum consisting of two spectral rays. A slightly more complex signal, such as a periodic square, with a non-symmetrical duty cycle, gives a spectrum consisting of the main harmonic, the leftmost ray, and complementary harmonics, all of which are multiples of the main frequency. Finally, in the case of a real periodic profile, which contains irregularities, we find the main frequency and its harmonics, but also other smaller rays around it, which represent the irregularities of the profile. The spectrum used in the spectral analysis represents amplitudes in ordinates, according to the frequency in abscissa. On a profile of n points, the frequencies are numbered from 0 to n-1. The associated wavelength depends on the order of the frequency in the spectrum and the length of the profile. Here, the spectrum is taken from a 30 mm long profile, with 60,000 points. We see that the first frequencies, the low frequencies, represent long wavelengths. Frequency number 10 represents a wavelength of 3 mm. But when you go up in frequency, you get very small wavelengths, the last of which correspond to noise or micro-roughness. The most useful part of a spectrum is therefore rather in the first left half of the spectrum. We also note that the long wavelengths, which represent a fraction of the length of the profile, are few. Here, we have only 1,000 frequencies to represent wavelengths from 30 millimeters to 30 micrometers, but 59,000 frequencies to represent wavelengths below 30 micrometers. In the case of a surface, the spectrum is two-dimensional, with an independent breakdown between the frequencies along the x-axis and the frequencies along the y-axis. We therefore represent the spectrum in the form of an image, where the color or the intensity represents the frequency amplitude. If we represent the transmission of a filter according to wavelength, we have the filter cutoff which separates the transmitted wavelengths from those which are attenuated. If you want to calculate the waviness, which is made up of the longer wavelengths, you have to attenuate the shorter ones. But a filter is not a switch that cuts everything before the cutoff and transmits everything afterwards. In reality, the filters, and in particular the Gaussian filter, have a progressive transmission curve. For short wavelengths, i.e. high frequencies, the filter attenuates almost everything. As we get closer to the cutoff value, the transmission curve rises. At the exact value of the cutoff, the transmission is 50%. So its attenuation is also 50%. Waviness, therefore, mainly contains longer wavelengths than the cutoff. As explained before, the roughness is then obtained by subtracting the waviness from the primary profile, which will then contain the shorter wavelengths. Note that around the cutoff, certain wavelengths present in the waviness are also found in the roughness, and vice versa. It is therefore important that the surface or profile components are well separated, and that there are no significant wavelengths at the cutoff value. When we vary the cutoff, we see that the shape of the filter's transmission curve remains the same, but is translated in wavelength. This type of graph is found in standards presenting filters, such as ISO 16610 Part 21, which describes the Gaussian filter for profiles. We can check the proper separation of the two components in the metrological filtering operator of the Mountain software by observing the roughness here in the center and the waviness on the right and by varying the cutoff. The roughness should contain only small height variations on an approximately flat background. The waviness should describe only the large variations of the topography, without any detail. By varying the cutoff, we can see how the wavelengths representing the different components of the surface texture are distributed between roughness and waviness. For example, the first filtering, with a cutoff of 4 mm, gives a roughness almost identical to the starting surface and a weak waviness. On the roughness, we see that the blue basin at the top right of the image is still pronounced, which means that the image still includes wavelengths that belong to the waviness. At the other end, with a cutoff of 0.2 mm, the waviness is almost identical to the starting surface and the roughness contains only noise. We can therefore eliminate the smallest cutoffs, because the waviness contains too many details. For a cutoff of 1 mm, one can ask the question, are there still too many details in the waviness? As we said before, we can also eliminate the 4 mm cutoff. Maybe even the 3 mm one. Visually, the waviness and roughness of the 2 mm and 1.5 mm cutoffs appear correct, with good separation of the surface texture components. It will be necessary to carry out tests at these cutoffs on several measured surfaces in order to verify the relevance of the results and their functional correlation. Once the right cutoff has been chosen, there will be a correct decomposition of the primary surface into waviness plus roughness. Some surface functions can be controlled using roughness parameters, for example, lubrication or friction. Other functions will be controlled using waviness parameters, for example, sealing. The ISO 16610 standard, which describes filters for profiles and surfaces, introduced a specific vocabulary. In particular, the term nesting index. It is in fact a generalization of the concept of cutoff. The term cutoff is perfectly appropriate for linear filters, because their effect relates specifically to the spectral content and the wavelengths. On the other hand, the term cutoff does not apply to morphological filters or to segmentation. The term nesting index, therefore, encompasses the concepts of cutoff, structuring element size, and wolf pruning value in segmentation. Then, the concept of S-filter describes a filter that attenuates short wavelengths, S for short. It is therefore a filter used, for example, for generating the waviness profile. Be careful not to confuse it with the micro-roughness filter used on profiles with the lambda S cutoff. The L filter attenuates long wavelengths, L for long. It is used, for example, for generating the roughness profile. We also have the F operator that removes the form. It can be an association or a filter. The combination of these filters make it possible to create scale-limited surfaces, called SL surface or SF surface. In signal processing, we commonly use low-pass filters. This means that the filter passes low frequencies. And we have seen that the low frequencies correspond to the long wavelengths. Therefore, a low-pass filter is an S-filter. S-filter which attenuates the small wavelengths, therefore lets the long wavelengths pass. Conversely, the high-pass filter allows high frequencies, and therefore short wavelengths, to pass. It is an L-filter. A band-pass filter passes frequencies within a given band, by using the combination of a low-pass filter and a high-pass filter, resulting in an SL filter. The ISO 21920 Part 2 standard defines the SL and SF profiles. It should be kept in mind that the names S and L designate a mode of operation of the filter. We either attenuate the small or the long wavelengths. They do not concern the cutoff value. In an SF profile, the S filter can have a small cutoff, NIS, which makes it a micro-roughness filter, with a lambda S cutoff, as used in the primary profile. Or, it may have a larger NIC cutoff, equivalent to the lambda C used in the waviness profile. In the case of an SL profile, equivalent to a roughness profile, the cutoff of the S filter will be small, NIS, equivalent to lambda S, and the cutoff of the L filter will be NIC, equivalent to lambda C. It is also possible to create a bank of band-pass filters by taking cutoff values NIS and NIC that are fairly close or even identical, and filter the profile at several narrow bands in order to carry out a multi-scale exploration. The same concepts exist for surfaces, with SL and SF surfaces, defined in ISO 25-178 Part 2. In the case of a surface, the concepts of roughness and waviness are however less relevant, because it is quite possible to have a roughness behavior along the x-axis and a waviness behavior along the y-axis. The ISO 16610 standard, dedicated to profile and surface filters, is made up of many parts, each dealing with a type of filter. Some parts remain to be developed, especially on the surfaces, but they will be published in the future. The difference between these types of filters and their particular use is described in an article of the Metrology Guide devoted to filtering techniques. Do not hesitate to refer to it for more information. Thanks for watching this video. Feel free to comment and indicate your needs for future videos. Click on the like button below this video. And subscribe to the channel to be notified when new videos are uploaded. Find other resources on the Surface Metrology Guide. And visit www.digitalsurf.com to learn more about Mountain software. Thank you.